much. It's a great honor for me to be here. And I'm really looking forward to show you a little bit what we do. But first of all, I have to give a big thanks and lots of thanks to the Far Eastern Group, to the people and the group, the entire group, and the people we are working since 6 years together, and especially to Chairman Douglas Hsu, which he has told already the story how we met 6 years ago, and I was very, very proud, and I was very, very surprised that he had so much confidence in us and in me as a person, really to give this important project and this very, very challenging task also in our hands.
谢谢各位来，我今天很荣幸在这边，来跟大家谈谈我们所做的事情。那么，在一开始尤其要谢谢远东集团里面的每一个分子，那么尤其是徐董事长。各位刚刚已经听到关于我们认识的经过，那么的确在6年前，我非常自豪，那么我其实也当时非常的惊喜，那么他相信我们，他相信我可以来做这个 project。
So, and what I would love to do is also because our work is not just one or two guys, it's really a very talented team, and a team in the meantime on different parts of the world. And as we have also really, I think, a team with a very, very strong spirit, what we think, what is needed to do this work.So I want to really bring also and remind and bring really the team also here to you as an audience, because this is really also a very strong base as a multicultural team to work on different parts of the world and to consider with water also the cultural part and the cultural context where we work.
那么我特别要跟大家说，那么我们的案子其实是一个团队努力的结果啊。我要说的是一个团队，也就是表示说是从世界各地来的人。那么我们作为一个团队，我们如果说到这个世界各地，这也意味着是一个多元的文化。那么这也意味着在各式各样的多元的文化里面，水作为文化的一部分的考虑而组成这样子的团队。
So you see, we have teams in Portland, US. We have our group, our team in Germany, in Überlingen, that's the south of Germany. And we have in the meantime also two very, very motivated and passionate teams in Asia. One team in Beijing.And one team in Singapore.
那么所谓的这个多元文化的团队是哪里呢？总共有四个地方，比如说在波特兰的美国的波特兰市，那么另外在这个德国的南部的这个最早的这个部分，那另外还有两个办公室在亚洲，在北京还有在新加坡。
And I want to thank also Leonard Nshi, who is in the back, who was coming from Singapore and supporting me here for this lecture. So he will also be available later on if there are further questions.
我也要特别谢谢从新加坡远道来站在后面的 Leonard.那么他是我们团队的一部分，他特别来这里支援我。那么如果有任何的这个事情，在今天结束晚一点的时候，他也会跟我一起来回答各式各样的问题。
So this is something what I would like always to show a little bit where are our roots, because to have a very particular approach in the work, I think it needs really something which is rooting back in the personality and also in the philosophy. And this is a picture what I have taken through 2 or 3 weeks ago from my office in Germany, and you see it's a view over the lake. And this is the Lake of Constance. And you can see this lake, it's a lake in Middle Europe, between three countries. It's Austria, Switzerland, and Germany. And this lake, and I will explain that shortly, this lake embodies basically the core of our work.
那么我永远非常我永远喜欢用我个人的观点来做一个这个演讲的开始。那我先给大家看的是我拍的照片，那这张照片是我们事务所外面的一个湖，这个湖在位于中欧，那么它事实上呢临界着三个国家，分别是瑞士、这个奥地利还有德国。那么它是在我们这个公司外面的这个湖。
Because I will talk a little bit also about the theme which is very trendy today. It's eco-city, doing urbanization in an ecological way. But what I always feel is that we have to really put that a little bit deeper and really put also our passion, our inner passion into this work. Otherwise, it's really only something at the surface. And what this lake is about, this lake has three major components of our work. It is a retention basin in a European scale, yeah, because you have the outflow of the Rhine River, which continues 900 kilometers through Switzerland, French, Germany, and Netherlands. And you have here in that lake 4 million people who use that as a drinking freshwater resource for their drinking water. And you have a few hundred thousand people who are living around the lake and use the lake as recreational area. So all parts of our life are really take part in this lake or at the lake.
那么我特别跟大家谈这个湖，除了刚刚提到的它的位置以外，我们事务所的作品的某一种精神性的中心就是关于这个湖。那怎么说呢？这个湖呢，事实上对我来说起码有三层的意义。这三层的意义是这样子的，作为这个三个国界当中的这个湖，它是一个很重要的有蓄水功能的这个湖。那么它在这边呢提供了瑞士、德国还有荷兰等等的这些人的这个蓄水池。那大约有400万的人也用这个水池来供应生活的这个用水。那么另外呢还有一个原因，那么有一些人就住在这些湖的旁边，所以这些湖呢又有休闲的功能，所以这三个功能呢代表着这个湖对我的意义。那这些意义呢在表面上这个当我们今天在提永续啦、生态啦这些很流行的大名词、抽象的大概念的后面，其实有对我来说有一个真正深刻的内在的热情。那这个热情对我来说就建立在对这个湖的态度、这个湖的三个功能上面。
And talking about authentic approach, this is, and I want to take you a little bit.How we developed as people and how we developed as a design team and as thinkers. This is a project where water, collection of water here in the public realm, integrating it as a public space for people in an urban environment, in a community. This is almost 30 years ago. So what we are doing is not something what we...catched up a few months, a few weeks, a few years ago. This is something what we already invented as a concept almost 30 years ago.
所以呢，再一次，我们在谈这些流行的概念以前，这些在我心里面深处很重要的事情，除了刚刚我已经提过的这个湖以外，第二个 我想给各位看一下这张照片。这是一个案子，它位于一个都市的这个中心。那这个案子呢，是30年前的一个作品，它位于都市里面。然而呢，在30年前，我们已经去想水怎么收集水，那么水跟环境、跟都市里面的这个其他的这个道路系统跟公共空间之间的关系。
But how to take that further was then the question for us, how to take that further in the world, in a very fast moving world where we have a lot of other challenges. You see here, that was 2001 when we accomplished a green roof in an entirely dense city in Chicago, the green roof of the Chicago City Hall. And this is not a little bit decoration to paint the roof green. This green roof brings a positive effect, and it's only a starting point, positive effect to improve city climate, to keep and slow down water, because Chicago launched a program at that point in time to really spread green roofs and to do something positive for their drainage system because it was overloaded.
所以呢，以刚刚这个第二个案子来说的，各位注意到是将近30年前，我们已经企图把一个跟水有关、城市有关的这个水的这个处理，作为都市的基盘建设的一部分，作为景观的一部分。可是怎么再拿那个再往前呢？这第三个这个案例对我很重要的，则是在这个芝加哥，那么在这个面对这个快速变迁环境跟世界里面呢，去做一个这个屋顶，绿屋顶。那么这个绿屋顶呢，不是只是一张画一般的放在那上面啊，这是当时芝加哥为了面对即将迅速改变的世界，在屋顶，那么请我们做了这样子的案子。
But what's today? What kind of challenges do we have today? This is just a short.And most of you know what's going on in the world. So we have still an increase of world population, some in different parts of the world. But I don't want to go into detail. But there's simply one thing what shows here. This is for me very, very interesting. We have a decrease of population in Europe. So in Europe, we have to deal with completely different problems than the rest of the world.So we have to, and I come back to this later in the projects, we have to deal, and we have to remind ourselves, we have to deal with an infrastructure where we have to think and we have to develop something to get the cost and to maintain a big infrastructure, what we don't need in the future, because the cities are shrinking. And what to do with a big infrastructure?
那么30年前的作品，还有刚刚芝加哥10年前的作品，那今天呢，我们怎么面对今天的世界呢？看一下这个这张表格，这张表格表示像我在所处的欧洲，我们正面临了人口的这个降低，那人口的降低也意味着城市在缩减，那面对人口的缩减跟城市的缩减，我们应该怎么处理我们的基盘建设的问题？这意味着庞大的基盘建设会有更少的人，更这个已经缩小的城市来支撑，像这样子的事情。
And beside that, I'm coming slowly to the main topic of today of water. I mean, I can just remember, and this is for me always interesting.That's roughly the time when I was born. So we consumed about this kind of water for agriculture, industry, and municipal use. But today, we consume almost double of that water. And what is the prospect in the future? I think the water resources are limited. Chairman Douglas has described that already.But this is a big problem for all societies.
让我们再来看这个表格。用这张表格，我越来越靠近我今天要讲的主题。我请各位看一下这张表格。 我刚指出来的是我出生的时候，这个水的用量。那么当时每一个人在这个城市里面消耗，当时这样子的分量的水，我们今天每一个人所消耗的水的分量，已经是我出生时候的两倍。那未来呢？看起来只有不断持续的成长。徐董事长刚刚说的对，水资源的问题会是我们将来必须面对的严重问题。
And it's not only water; it's also all other natural resources. What we have on our earth are really very much in danger. You know, it's about land degradation, the arable land.Which is basically the base for our food is decreasing. We have, and that's also something important here in our project. We have a lot of problem with pollution, polluted water, and we have also a decrease in biodiversity. And I think biodiversity is also something I will come back in some of the projects.
所以我们谈的只是水吗？其实不是。我们谈水的时候，我们其实也在谈世界上所有的自然资源。我们可以非常快地理解，生物所需要的土、土的干化跟贫瘠、水的污染，还有非常重要的生物多样性。生物多样性、生物的减少，那么是这个严重的问题。我将来在这个演讲的最后会提到关于生物多样性的问题。
But bringing that and turning that into numbers, I mean, just in terms of water, 2025, two-thirds of the world will live under water stress, and one-quarter of the world population will live under water scarcity. What that means, if you are not sure and certain if you have enough drinking water next day,I think that's a dangerous and that's an unbelievable situation where we really have to take into account about what are our priorities when we move forward with our urbanization process and also with other activities.
所以我们再来看一下这个数字，这是一个令人诧异的数字。在2025年，十年再多一点点的时间，我们有世界上三分之二的人口在这个会生活在这个缺水的这个恐慌跟恐惧下面的威胁下面，而非常明确的是，有四分之一的世界上的人口就已经是缺水的状况了，所以。所以呢，我要说的事情是在城市化的过程当中，我们这个要思考清楚我们的这个面临的最主要的问题会是什么。
So the UN Water Commission put the integrated water resource management, a long, long word, on first priority. But what is that, and how can we implement that in our reality? Somehow, I have the feeling that nobody knows what this is, and nobody knows.How can we put that into reality?
所以呢，你会注意到这个联合国的水资源处，他告诉大家，在面对未来世界的时候，第一个要项的重要事情是什么呢？是要做水资源整合管理，就是那四个英文字，这个IWRN。那么可是什么是水资源整合管理呢？我相信没有人知道那是什么意思。
And also, Chairman Su mentioned that this is not only about the resources. I think this will have an impact, a strong impact to our society. It will have also a strong impact how countries are living together in the future. So it's more than just.Water, food, health—it's really also about world peace in the future.
所以，正如徐董事长跟大家点出来的事情一样，我们在谈水的时候，其实这就是世界上要面临的首要问题。不只是水，不只是所水跟有关的食物的问题，不只是水食物所引起的健康上的问题，其实不只是水食物健康 更重要的，甚至在最后是关于世界和平的问题。
But just because coming slowly to the point, what is our role as Atelier Dreiseidel? We are already introduced as people who care about water, and this is certainly our center. But we see this topic in the meantime very, very closely linked to all parts, to all areas and fields what we have in our life.
所以呢，在中心的问题是水，可是由水，连接到我们这个世界上还有生命里面，的各式各样的问题，各式各样的区块。
And this is culture.
文化。
Urbanization process.
城市化。
This is infrastructure.
基盘建设。
And it's basically nature.
自然。
And this is how we see that.This is really a very, very linked system. This is not separated part where infrastructure is a completely different topic. This is something which is really, really closely interrelated.
所以我要说的事情就是这四个，再一次，文化、城市、基盘建设，还有自然，这四个构建其实是相互串在一起、整合在一起的。我必须再一次重再重要的重申一次，这四个并不是分开的。我们要说的就是这四个如何重叠在一起。
A little bit further, water today means in urbanized areas how to deal with those challenges. We have big topics in terms of safety.Flow control, we have topics of flooding, we have topics of scarcity, droughts, scarcity of water in big parts of the world, and finally also water quality, pollution of water.
所以呢，在城市化的过程当中，水的问题绝对是一个重要的一个问题。那我们所面对的四个重要的，包括水的这个安全，水的供给。等等，这四个重要的这个问题，包括这水的供给系统等等，是我们所都要面对的。
I want to take you a little bit in our world where we always test also how can we learn from water because water is showing a lot of abilities what for us as humans and also.In our daily life, I think could be very, very valuable. So water is always with the landscape. It's a system. It's a system where this interacts. This is depending from each other. Vegetation, topography, water is shaping that. Instead of, I would say, the artificial system in urban settings.
那么我们在这过程当中，我自己常试图去从水来做学习。那么我有兴趣的是水在我们的环境里面，它跟这个地形等等跟植物的关系，而不是右边这一张它就是一个这样子的这个穿过我们的环境的一个这个水系统而已。
Water has different scales, and the scales and connection, like a water net, or scale like how much beauty a small drop as a plant could have.This is important to understand.
那另外一个要注意的，跟我从水这边学习到的是跟这个尺度有关系。那么水呢，在各种不同的尺度底下，都具有他们自己的生命。
And basically, also to understand natural water cycles, and finally, going to the question how to implement that in urban settings, how to transform that.In urban areas and support working cycling systems.
然后还有一个是关于水在这个我们的环境里面的系统。那么在我们的环境里面，水是怎么样被我们来循环来使用？在我们的系统里面，它如何的这个不断的循环
？Or understanding water even much deeper and understanding the phenomena, the hidden, sometimes hidden phenomena of water, So this is a photo of a satellite photo of the Galapagos Islands where we have volcanoes, and if a cloud formation is drifting through this area, so we see this kind of flow patterns in a square kilometer scale.
所以我们要学我所学的关跟水有关的第四个主题是这个更胜一进一步的去了解这个水的这个流动的系统，譬如以右边这个幻灯片来讲，是一个这个卫星图形。那这个卫星图形是在谈在火山的四周所形成的这些气流，这些气流很明显的可以影响到旁边周边的这个云系的环境。
You can explore the same phenomenon on a table with one square meter. If you work with the water, it's exactly the same phenomenon what you see in square kilometers on one square meter. So that tells you a little bit that we are living in a system, and water is a very, very fundamental element on our planet.
所以右面这张是从卫星云图里面所看到的火山跟它所引起的云系之间的流动，但是我要跟各位说，各位所看到的学习到从卫星上面的这些事情，即使是在一米平方的一个小小的环境里面，几乎可以完全复制所谓的各种云系对流，各种这个关于水流动的状况。那我要所说的事情就是我们在这么小的地方也可以理解，从这种小的也可以理解这么大的环境的事情。那我在这里为各位再整理一下，他刚刚说他从这个四个方向来学到跟水有关的，一个是关于水在我们自然环境里面，包括跟地形，第二个是跟尺度，第三个是循环系统，第四个是从更这个巨观的这种地球的这个流动系统来理解。
But finally, what is also very important when we work in public space and when we work with water is to understand and to consider the human scale, how people, how all generations can be part, can make experience, and can be in our cities, get a comfortable scale and get as much as possible really one-to-one experience withwater and with the natural environment.
那么除了这前面四个以外，第五个也最重要的其实是跟人互动的关系，也就是在跟人的尺度、人的系统里面，在这种一对一的状况里面，水跟每一个人经验之间的关系。
So again, how to work in urban settings? So if we look at our cities, we see basically.The surface, we see architecture, we see streets, plazas, parks. This is one part of a city.
那么，我们用这个在企图作为一个这个描述我们所理解的城市。我们看到的城市其实只是冰山的一角。
But the other part of a city, which is not visible, which is not easy to understand, this is something where we think we should really. Sorry.We should really look at this as a system, as something which works much, much smoother for the environment in the future.
然而在冰山的一角的下面，其实是有一大部分是常常很多人不能理解的。那么这就是我们城市下面里面的一个巨大的、庞大的这个基盘建设的系统。
So therefore, I'm starting to show you some showcases, some projects, and I want to take you on a trip. So we will start somewhere in US, in Europe, and we will come at the end here to Taipei to make it also and to link it here to the place. And I have grouped those projects a little bit in some topics. So as we are discussing today, lots of very...current issue, because what we are doing, design and infrastructure, is also linked very much to politics, so and to economics. We are not separated.
那么，所以就像刚刚那张图，冰山上的一角下面是有一个非常复杂的系统。那这些复杂的系统呢，组织成我们的世界。那从这个方面呢，我特别列了这个六个 策略。那在这六个策略里面呢，我将为各位介绍，我们一开始是会从美国跟欧洲的案例，那么逐渐往后面介绍。那介绍最后呢，我会回到我们今天所在的地方。那在这些介绍的过程当中呢，我必须指出来，这个政治跟经济都是这些问题的这个或策略的环节里面的一部分。